we were not created to live stagnant lives, to be stuck, bound, or broken. We were created with a purpose, a calling, a mandate, a mission. Even in these uncertain times, that calling remains the same. To go into the world, to make disciples, to share the love of Jesus. This is the work of Easter. The greatness of God, the power of the resurrection in action. What Jesus did has changed us, made us a new creation, given us an unimaginable hope. Grace has taken root. Mercy has flooded our souls, and the promise of eternity has redefined our everything. So why keep all that to ourselves? It's time to put Easter in motion, to make a difference, to share Jesus with the world around us. If your life has been changed, it's time to get to work.
Amen. Well, I'm back. a little tanner than I left. Definitely it was great to get away and to know that this church was in good hands with Rusty and Randy and Paolo and the singers, that the church happened. And it's very encouraging when I know that everything will be done and I don't have to worry about it. It is a good feeling, amen? So here we are, where it's the moment of sweet hour of prayer. We're going to be singing, if my choir up here, my ad hoc choir, as they come forward. This is a great song. It was written in the mid or late 1800s, and the The idea of the song is really a moment of surrender, that we know we need God, not just on Sunday at that a time of 10 o'clock or any other time. We need God every hour, sweet hour of prayer. God, thank you that you lived us, Lord, that you brought us here in this moment to give us this opportunity to be in your presence. Lord, let us cast aside the world and all the things that we may have brought in with us, Lord God. Let us leave the baggage that we carry at your altar and leave here, Lord God, in this next time, the next 10, 20, 30, 40 minutes that it takes to have worship here, Lord. We thank you that you've given us this opportunity. Allow everything that we sing and say and do reflect the glory that we have in our hearts for you. And we ask all this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. I have no announcements unless somebody has something they want to offer as an announcement. Announcements. No announcements? I love it. Yeah. Well, if there's something to announce, let me know. let's offer the call to worship as it's printed as overhead. Almighty God, through your only Son, you overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. Help us by the renewing of your Spirit to truly celebrate our Lord's resurrection, so that we may rise from the death of our own sin into the life of your righteousness through Jesus Christ. Amen. Man of sorrows.
As he stood at
Thank you, God, that you did pour out your love for us on that cross. And Lord, we thank you for your mercies that are new every day. And so we praise you, Lord, that even in the moments when we have forgotten to do your will and we have broken your law, and we've not heard the cry of the needy in our midst, and we've turned our backs on our responsibility as Christians, Lord, that when we turn around back to you and repent with a truly repentant heart, that you forgive us. So that we can declare in this moment, as we consider everything we may have done or not done to bring glory to your Son, Jesus Christ, that when we say this and acknowledge it in the name of Jesus Christ, we are all forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. We thank you, Lord, that you gave us this opportunity also to know a simple prayer that defines how we are to behave on a daily basis to all we encounter. When you taught your disciples to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my bed.
This morning's scripture is from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 48. Jesus appears to the disciples. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, Peace be with you. They were startled and frightened, thinking they'd seen a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of God for the people of God.
My name is James, and I'm one of the disciples, but not the one you're thinking of. I'm the other one, James the Lesser. That's what the disciples would call me to distinguish between the two of us. Through the years, that's why I started calling myself. That's how I thought of myself. I was the last disciple picked. I was never the top dog. But none of that matters anymore. Because Jesus was sealed in a tomb, and 3 days later, he flipped life as we know it on its head. It was evening, we were all in this large room, and he appeared. And when I say that he appeared, I mean he was not there. And then all of a sudden, there he was. And he was telling us to calm down. He was telling us something about peace. I don't know. He was saying something about food. And I don't know if you work up an appetite conquering death. Needless to say, we were terrified, excited, and happy. Yeah, we were really happy. We thought it was over. We thought all of this was done. But instead, he put death in its place. He did it. He did it. And when I look at myself, I see the disappointment. I see the dismissal. I see the lesser. And I realize I'm pretty forgettable. But then I remember, he did it. He conquered death. He did it for me. Because of the cross, because of Christ, I am redeemed, reborn even. He has set me free from my sin. He has set me free from myself. And I do not mind having less of me, if it means I can have so much more of him.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come join together and to praise and worship you and to thank you for the life, the death, and the resurrection of your Son, Jesus, and all he's done for us. Lord, right now we ask that you lay your hands upon Pastor Tom and let him share your words through his mouth that we may hear whatever it is you need us to hear today. Let his words be your words and let us just soak it in. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Amy. Well, it's Easter Sunday. Later in the day, as the reading opens in Luke's Gospel, and we've entered right into the midst of the disciples hearing about the news from the two had met Jesus on the road to Emmaus. Now, couple that with the fact that they had also heard earlier in the morning Mary come back to them and tell them, and also John and Peter, the good news of the empty tomb, and it's left these men in this particular situation. Confused. They don't really know how to wrap their mind around all that's transpired at this moment. So they're trying to grasp the ramifications of all this information. One of my favorite authors, and I've used him before, is Max Lucado. And I know I've used this illustration in the past, but you don't remember it, so let me read it again. It's from his book, 6 Hours on One Friday. The Church of Jesus Christ began with a group of frightened men on the second floor in Jerusalem. Though they marched with Jesus for 3 years, they now sat afraid. They were timid soldiers, reluctant warriors, speechless messengers, though daring to dream that the Master had left them some word, some plan, some direction, so they came back. But little did they know that their wildest dream was not wild enough. As they sat there talking, they hear a noise, and now they see Jesus standing before them. The betrayed one has now sought his betrayers. Now, and you can imagine their collective gasps for a second. Just, wow, it's him. Now, what did he say to them? He didn't say, "Now, what a bunch of flops you were. Not I told you so. Not where were you when I needed you." No, speech as though he didn't say that. I would have. I'm sure none of you would have said something like that. But at the very least, I would have given them the silent treatment. I'm really good at that. Again, I'm glad the only one here. Now, even though guilt is a really pretty powerful force in the universe, as we don't use that ourselves, it's apparent that Jesus wasn't laying any guilt on them in this particular moment. Instead, what he offered them was what they didn't have, peace. They didn't have that. They had the unsureness. And in spite of that, even though this entrance does startle them, and they quickly surmise this, it's a ghost. Jesus is a ghost. So to calm their hearts and their minds down, Jesus offers them to look at his scarred hands and his feet, and he even suggests they can touch him if they want, just to prove he's not a ghost. And the scriptures say this: they struggled still to believe because the good news was too good to be true. So, to prove he was really back in the flesh, he sits down and has some fish with them. He opened their minds then with the Bible study and their hearts and minds to receive salvation that runs through the entire Bible. And the point of all this is that Jesus is giving them evidence to prove he really is back, that he really has been resurrected from the dead. Now, just for the record, if any one of us were there, we would also be startled, amen? And terrified. That's the truth. And all those words sum up how many of us would behave in the face of unexpected news, both good and bad. Really, unexpected news can be good? And we have the same reaction between unexpected news that's good and bad? Well, generally, no matter what form you're being given, whether it's good or bad news, many times people say to me, "I hope you're sitting down." Good thing you're all sitting down this morning. So here they are, they're in this process, and they just need, they just need to understand, there are such responses as bad news, as, it takes you a little time to understand what's going on, but as I said, the same reaction as good happens. It takes a little bit of time to process what you've learned. Plus, let's not forget the emotional trauma these men have endured over the just 3 days earlier. And that alone has had to be leaving them feeling insecure, at best, that any good news couldn't possibly be happening right now. So I envision them sitting around somewhat waiting for the next bad thing to happen. And the truth is, there are some things, church, that are too good to be true. There are. And that we should approach those things with some apprehension. You know, this past week, the world was just reminded of a situation with that particular situation with the passing of Bernie Madoff. You all know Bernie Madoff. His name is synonymous with financial fraud. He was convicted of swindling at least $20 billion that he and associates inflated to a value of $60 billion. And during his trial, one person after another testified that they freely gave Bernie Madoff the money, in spite of the fact that knowing the returns he was posting were, and I quote, in their words, too good to be true. And in reality, they were. Too good to be true. Yet, church, for some reason, I think maybe it was greed, they couldn't resist the temptation, and they freely gave their money. You know, we live in a place in the world, too, that we know we're inundated with things just like that on a daily basis that seem too good to be true, and for the most part, they are. I learned a really valuable lesson years ago when I was in high school. During the summers, I would set up swimming pools for my junior and my senior year, and these above-ground pools, many of the customers told me that the reason why they purchased the pool was because it was advertised. An 18 by 4 foot by 18 pool was advertised for $99. Yes, I am that old. $99. So they bought the pool. And then they realized, oh, that didn't include the installation, the ladder to get in and out of the pool with, the filter, and the cover. But they were already in. They were in too deep. And so they soon found out all that didn't matter. So I got to tell you, though, we all hear it all the time. We get a starting price, and we think that that's going to be the reality. And then, you know, there's just hundreds of examples from your cell phone minutes to an extended warranty on any product you buy. It's more money. So the very savvy among us, we're always waiting for the catch, right? Especially when the good news is too good, waiting for that. What's the catch? What's the catch in all this? We're conditioned to believe it sounds too good to be true. It is. It probably is. Yet once in a while, church, every once in a while, we get pleasantly surprised that something too good to be true can actually be genuine. You know, I have to say this. This is an aside from my personal perspective. If I saw somebody walking around 3 days after I did a funeral for them, I'd be a little more than uncomfortable. And not that I wouldn't be happy for them, I would, but I'm not sure how I would transpire it. And I think it would take me more than a few minutes to process what my eyes were telling me, and then maybe a lifetime to understand how it all happened. So it's no wonder that Jesus' followers were slow to believe the good news, because it's true even some 2,000 years later, people are afraid to accept the good news as being good or truthful. You know, it could be that they're afraid that if they make that commitment, that they might be making it to an illusion. Wow. Truthfully, all of us live with that possibility. But church, this was not an illusion to those first disciples. They examined his hands and his feet. They ate a meal with him. And then after doing all that, they shared that experience with others. So while we don't have firsthand knowledge or physical touching Jesus or eating with him, we do have their testimony, which is on record, and I think it's trustworthy. You know, the fact is we trust historical records all the time. And just this past Wednesday was the 156th anniversary of Abraham Lincoln's assassination. And I think it's safe to say that regardless that we don't have any videotape of that event or any eyewitnesses who are still alive to bring that testimony, to the person in this church, we believe that event happened. We can pretty much be assured of that. And the same is true regarding Jesus' resurrection. While it might be too wonderful for our minds to comprehend, it does not diminish its reality. Now, see, to me, the biggest proof of resurrection is in how Jesus still changes lives today on a basis when people become a believer in him. Now, you may not know, or you may know the story of a woman, a singer, very popular singer back in the 40s, Ethel Waters. Her famous signature song was "His Eye Is on the Sparrow." Now, Waters was born to a mother who was 12 years old. Right. She lived growing up fast in the slums. She earned her first money by running errands for prostitutes. Who could have imagined the change that would have to take place in Ethel Waters' life when she first encountered Jesus Christ? As she described it, she was headed, she says, towards self-destruction when the Savior of the world stepped in and offered her a new life. See, and church, that has continued to happen to countless other lives over the past 2,000 years. For those who are willing to believe the good news, it's not too good to not believe in it. Are you with me this morning, church? Yes. Amen. See, and I also think there's another reason why people are afraid to accept the good news of the risen Christ. It's because it might require some change in the way they have behaved, the way they've been living their lives. You see, the thing is that many of those people who don't want change are living in a rut, and they're wondering why they're not getting ahead. Yet, they're quite content to stay that way. They essentially don't want anything to upset their routine. So that if that's you this morning and you're here, you may not want to listen to the rest of this message. You see, if you want change in your life, you need to be careful, though, if you don't want it. You have to be careful because anyone who accepts the resurrection, they'll no longer be able to live or be content to live with any half-baked commitment to Jesus Christ or his purpose in the world for us. As someone put it, those early disciples met the risen Christ and they were forever changed. They enlisted in his cause. They gave up everything they had to serve him. The question is, church, this morning, have you made that discovery yet? Because there is no joy in any half-baked faith, leaving many would-be followers with just enough religion to make them miserable. Yeah, take that one home. Put that one in your pocket. I have just enough religion to make me miserable. Isn't that horrible? Church, Jesus wants to make our lives a miracle. A miracle he's offering us. And those early disciples, yeah, they had trouble believing at first for fear, then for joy. But when they did believe, when they truly did believe, it turned their lives around, and then they turned the world upside down. Now, if you're here and you've not experienced the joy of an Easter morning and you want to, but you're afraid to believe in the good news simply because it's too good to be true, well, then ask yourself if you're willing to open your life to the risen Christ and allow him to make that radical change happen. See, the proof of the resurrection, Jesus, it just comes simply by asking or allowing the Holy Spirit to take full possession of you. And the proof of the resurrection then will reside in you and everything that you do. You know, I thank God, though, and I hope this is an amen, I thank God that the Gospels of the New Testament do not demand that we have to understand all this. We don't. Rather, they just offer an opportunity to open our mind to the insight that Christ understands each and every one of us. That's the Gospel. You see, so we don't have to fully understand Easter to experience Easter. Jesus is alone is the only one who inspires magnificent visions and who ministers to those whose dreams have been shattered. He's the one known as the Prince of Peace. and who doesn't shy away from chaos or conflict. He alone is the one who taught us how to pray, who accepts people who are so troubled and lost, no matter how they feel. Some people are so lost, they don't even think they have a prayer that their life could change for the better. You've all heard my story over these last 7 years, and you know from the very depth of my own experience, I can tell you, when I was in the total basement of discouragement, emotionally speaking, and I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, it was His presence that turned my life around. And then I accepted by faith alone His resurrection, because I had a new life that I could show as evidence to His life in me. And in return, I just received His loving encouragement along the way. Well, a couple times I've been corrected, believe me, that doesn't feel good too either, but listen, Jesus offers every one of us the same opportunity to a new and a better life, a new and a better way to behave, for anyone who asks for it. And I know that might seem for some too good to be true to believe, but for me, it's too good not to believe. Let's pray. And all the things, Lord, You've given us this opportunity to know You and to have received Your blessing and the opportunity for new life. Now help that one person in this morning who may be here, Lord God, and wants a new start, wants a new direction, and needs a Savior of the world. We thank You, Lord, if that person in this moment would just confess with their heart and open their hearts to the possibility that You are the living Lord, that in this moment, Lord, they would receive Your blessing. And we thank You, Jesus, for always offering this. And we ask all this in His precious name. Amen. His eye is on the sparrow. Only trust him. Stand if you'd like. Lord, we thank you that you would save us, and you have saved us, Lord. You've offered salvation, and we've accepted it. And we now, Lord, as we go forth into the world, help us to be fearless for you, Lord God. Help us to go where angels would tread, and to offer the opportunity for people to know the peace that surpasses all understanding. And in these days and weeks to come, Lord God, guide our feet and our hearts in the right direction for your Son, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Go in peace. Well, Paolo will have a prelude. Postlude. Thank you.
we want to sit here all day and listen.